and I think most people in Scotland, presiding officer, agree with us.
My apologies to Richard Simpson. I'm afraid I need to move on. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale on women offenders. Members who wish to take part in the debate should press the request to speak button now.
Thank you. We now turn to the debate on, in the name of Kezia Dugdale and women offenders, and I call on Kezia Dugdale to speak to and move the motion. 14 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to devote Labour business time to the issue of female offending. It is to our collective shame that the female population of our prisons has doubled in the lifetime of this Parliament, particularly as crime rates have fallen. In opening, I intend to outline why this issue of female offending matters, what it does to women, children, families and communities, and then I will look at the alternatives to prison, how we grow and develop these, ensuring the sustainability of their funding, with a specific focus on the impact of imprisonment on children and the consequences of that. But first, let me address the issue of the proposed super prison in Inverclyde. I wholeheartedly welcome the decision of the new Justice Secretary to abandon the plans for the 350-capacity prison in Inverclyde. It is a welcome U-turn and is a credit to all those who have made the case over the past few weeks and months, including Women for Independence, and in the case of the Howard League, for years. I was actually astonished to see that in the Government's amendment to Labour's motion, they have removed all reference to that coalition of views that have come to that point, and indeed the section about the cross-party support and wider stakeholder support for the issues that we're discussing today. I was quite disappointed to see that. It is a U-turn, Presiding Officer, because the plans for this prison were very much advanced. The Chief Inspector of Prisons told the Justice Committee in 2012 that not only would the prison be in Inverclyde, but the exact location, noting that the land and building permissions had been sought and that the cost would be £70 to £100 million. He also said that we must plan for a prison of 300 and that it must run a service that is capable of servicing the courts. Annual reports on the progress towards the Angelini recommendations were made to the Parliament in 2012 and in 2013, each arguing that the new prison was in the spirit of the Angelini report. A letter to the Justice Committee in July of last year reiterated the build design of 300, which could be extended to 350 if necessary, and the land was cleared before Christmas. The pre-tender for the works was live on the Public Contracts Scotland website in September, with notes of interest closing before Christmas. And as of yesterday, Presiding Officer, the documents are still live on Public Contracts Scotland website. This jail was happening until the Cabinet Secretary took the brave and radical step to scrap it, and he should be congratulated for that. However, there are serious questions that flow from that decision. The project was live for 2 years and nodded along the way by the current First Minister and indeed the former First Minister. The Telegraph have reported that the Government has spent £7.8 million so far on the plans for the super prison. An astonishing figure, almost three times what we have spent in the last 2 years on alternatives to jail. Money which could have been spent much better, built on the sustainability of community-based disposals across the country. We then had the former Justice Secretary, Kenny McCaskill, welcoming the U-turn on Twitter, a reversal of his own decision. It was the theatre of the absurd, Presiding Officer. Moving on to the issue of the Angelini Commission, the U-turn is welcome because a large-scale prison wasn't in keeping with the Angelini report, a substantial piece of work with no less than 37 recommendations which achieved cross-party support. And I reiterate today the Labour Party's support for it. It was, of course, a commission on female offending, so it's worth taking a moment or two to reflect on why this is a gendered issue. Female offenders are far more likely to have suffered a trauma or series of traumas in their lives. Rape, homelessness, physical or sexual abuse, a history of addiction and neglect. 76% of women sent to jail last year were in for 6 months or less, and the most common crime was shoplifting. When I spoke to the staff at both the Willow Project and the 218 service, who I'll come on to in a second, they said in most cases the women stole to feed a habit, even or perhaps their own, or perhaps that of a partner. And I mention that simply to highlight that the best way to break the cycle of offending is to treat the root causes of it. I'll say more about that in a second. But first, it's important to say that we mustn't let this become a debate about who is hard or soft on crime. Labels like that only serve tabloid headlines. Our duty as legislators and as scrutineers is to focus on what works. And whilst I've mentioned that 76% of those in our jail last year were in for 6 months or less, it is important to state that just 5% of the women imprisoned last year were in for serious or violent offences, crimes which came with a custodial sentence of 4 years or more. And where the women are a danger to themselves or wider society, of course they should go to jail. Of course that is right, and that is in keeping with the Angelini report, which states that we need one small-scale national facility. I was very interested to hear the Cabinet Secretary's reflections on the sighting of this yesterday, and perhaps we'll hear more from him later on today. Moving on to the issue of the development of community disposals, Presiding Officer, I've been told by the Howard League to try and avoid the use of the word alternative, because that gives primacy to sentencing or custodial sentences. There are many great organisations working on alternatives at the moment, and I had the pleasure to visit three of them in the past few weeks. The Willow Project in Edinburgh, the 218 Service in Glasgow, and Tayside Council on Alcohol. The criminal justice social workers at Willow, and indeed at 218, say to me that their options, their alternatives as disposals, they're not the soft option. In fact, it's much harder for the women to use these services than it is to go to jail. Because, in the words of the social workers, it forces you to look at yourself in the mirror, to see yourself as you really are and face up to some of the real challenges in your life. These services offer health checks, yes, but also serious group work and one-to-ones, addiction clinics, and a full schedule of activity during the day to try and tackle the root causes of offending. The 218 project in Glasgow has just 12 residential spaces, and of course it deals with more people who attend on a day-to-day basis, but there are just 12 permanent residential beds. And it's quite often the case in Glasgow, Presiding Officer, that a sheriff may wish to send someone to the 218 project, but there is no room at the inn. We should aspire to have facilities like 218 across the whole of the country, removing that impediment from sheriffs. There is, of course, other associated housing issues which we can't ignore. Transitions out of projects like 218 and the Willow are just as important as the existence of the services themselves, particularly the security of housing. Many of the women in the 218 project have a tenancy, and the focus must be on retaining that tenancy because of the impact on their family. But their housing benefit is spent on maintaining that tenancy, which means the cost of their place at the Willow is carried by the Willow project or indeed by the 218 service. The alternative of that is the woman losing her tenancy, which then creates a homelessness problem, which is even harder to address when there's a shortage of one-bedroom properties. Presiding Officer, the focus has to be on breaking the cycle of offending, yes, but we must also look at relapse prevention, because it doesn't just stop at the end of the community disposal. What matters is the services beyond that, and I've already mentioned housing. But in Edinburgh, the Willow service encourages women to return at any point that they would ever require that service in their lifetime. The door is always open for people who need that additional bit of support. When the Angelini Commission reported, the Scottish Government awarded £3 million to 16 different projects across the country in order to build up community disposals. It was right to say that this isn't just core funding, and it certainly isn't revenue funding. It was there to build up a number of different opportunities around the country in the hope that they would be self-sustaining by criminal justice authorities. But I would ask the Minister, Presiding Officer, to comment on what now for those facilities. What evaluation has the Government done of their sustainability? I know that they're currently looking at the effectiveness of their projects, but are they examining just how much money they have left? One of the services that I've certainly visited in the last few weeks doesn't know if it has any money beyond the 31st of March of this year. And if we're serious about building up community disposals, we have to give them security of funding so they can continue to do the work that they are doing. Of course.
Stuart Stevenson.
I very much am in tune with what the member is saying. Let me start by saying that. But in particular, the Sir Optimus report that came out recently says that 80% of women offenders have a history of mental illness. And I note that's not a subject that the member has touched on or her motion. Will she therefore welcome that the government's motion introduces health into the debate that we're having today and swing behind the government in recognising that that's a very important part of this debate?
Cassie Tuckdale.
I would absolutely concur with that, Presiding Officer, and indeed there will be several Labour speakers this afternoon who will touch on mental health. I would have more sympathy for the member's position if his own government hadn't cut research funding for mental health within the last few days. The member is right to focus on mental health, but there is also the instance of other mentoring projects which exist in the future of their funding, and that's particularly pertinent to organisations like Bernardo's, which brings me on to the topic of children. Two-thirds of the women in our prisons have kids. At least we think that's what the numbers are. We don't have exact figures because, understandably, women aren't particularly keen to disclose because of the impact of that. But what we do know, Presiding Officer, is that if a man is jailed, the children of that man have a 95% chance of going on to live with their mum. However, if a mum is jailed, just 17% of the kids go on to live with their father. And what that means is that there is a much higher propensity of children to end up in care when their mother is jailed, and that is an issue that should concern us all. Bernardo's have a particular project in Corton Vale just now working with young women offenders under the age of 21. Not a single one of those mums at the moment currently has custody of their own children. Another project mentoring women who have experience of the criminal justice system operated by Bernardo's say that just one-third of the women accessing that project have custody to their own kids. This Parliament has done great work in this session around care leavers, and we should be proud of that, and these benches were certainly proud to support the Government and the Children and Young People Bill. But we must follow this through and focus on the needs of looked after children all along the way. Angelini's report also tells us that there are more children in Scotland affected by parental imprisonment than there are divorce, and that those children go on to have mental health problems. Up to 30% of them will develop mental health problems in their lifetimes. We need services which are focused on tackling those deep-rooted issues of poverty and inequality, and we need them now. We need to break that care leaver trajectory, which says that a child who is looked after is far more likely to go to jail than they are to university, and that is an issue which should concern us all. As the debate goes on this afternoon, Presiding Officer, you will hear from my colleague Elaine Murray, who will focus on the particular issues affecting women who are on remand. I spoke to one woman whilst I was at the 218 project who had been on remand for 8 weeks. And during that time, she lost custody of her children, and it took her 3 years to get those children back. That was a consequence of an 8-week stint on remand. My colleague Jane Baxter will focus on community justice centres, particularly in Fife, and Mary Fee will talk to us about families affected by imprisonment and the particular work that the cross-party group has done in this area, which she chairs. My colleague Richard Simpson will then come on to Labour's record, and it was particularly unfortunate, I think, to see a tweet from Christina McKelvey over the past few days, who sought to say, what had Labour ever done on this issue? Well, we will hear more about this afternoon, because Labour in office, and both Hugh Henry and Richard Simpson served as Parliament as Deputy Justice Ministers, did a tremendous amount of work on this issue. They set up drug treatment testing order courts, which I've spent an entire day in with Dr. Oliver Aldridge, a consultant psychiatrist who is a world-leading expert on these issues. And indeed, both Hugh Henry and Richard Simpson are responsible for the 218 project's inception. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I've said in the past few weeks that this Parliament is at a crossroads when it comes to female offending. We were about to spend £75 million on the wrong thing, whilst funding for the thing that works was about to run out. Half of that proposition has been resolved with the U-turn from the Justice Secretary this week, which we very much welcome, but the picture is not yet complete. I congratulate once again all the organisations who've been involved in campaigning on this issue and would emphasise the need to focus on cross-party support going forward. I look forward to hearing the debate from members and move the motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I now call on Michael Matheson to speak to and move Amendment 12160.2. Cabinet Secretary, 10 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I move the amendment in my name? Members will be aware that I announced on Monday that the Scottish Prison Service's plan for a women's prison in Inverclyde should not go ahead. That's because it did not fit with my vision of how a modern and progressive country should be addressing female offending. I believe we need to be bolder and to take a more radical and ambitious approach here in Scotland. When it comes to the justice system, we must be smarter with the choices we make and be more sophisticated in the way in which we deal with female offenders. And to do that, we need to make sure that we tackle the underlying causes of offending in the first place. That is about mental health, drug and alcohol use, and all of the other issues that can result in someone carrying out a criminal offence in the first place. But let me also be clear. There are some women who do need to be in prison, women who present an unacceptable risk to the community or to themselves. We also have a small number of young women who offend and who need to make sure that we have separate and appropriate facilities for them too. So when it comes to the way that we will deal with women who are sent to prison, we intend to have a separate national facility for high-risk women and a separate facility for young women. But for the majority of women who are sent to jail, I firmly believe that we should be investing in smaller regional and community-based custodial facilities across the country. This approach would be more closely aligned with the vision that was set out by Dame Eilish Angelini. The Commission on Women Offenders called for a radical reform of the existing system and working practices across the criminal justice system and in the way in which universal services such as housing, welfare benefits and healthcare interact with women in order to help them make positive changes and build the skills that they need in order to move away from a life of offending. And I also want to make sure that happens. I said on Monday, Presiding Officer, I will now enter a period of dialogue, and that's exactly what I will do. I will work collaboratively with partners from across the sector who have a serious contribution to make to this debate. Presiding Officer, whilst it's obviously for the courts to decide who receives a custodial sentence, I also believe that we too continue to lock up too many women who are at low risk and are being sent to prison. I want to take a new approach in dealing with these types of offenders and provide them with the best possible support to help them to turn their lives around. I'm absolutely committed to reducing the female prison population in Scotland. But let me be clear, there are no quick solutions to this, and there is no one-size-fits-all approach to dealing with it. The evidence tells us that community-based residential units are better at supporting women to make positive changes in their lives by providing a safe, structured environment to help them improve health and well-being and address many of the underlying issues that contribute towards their offending behaviour, such as substance misuse. Women offenders are far less likely to be a danger to the public compared to men. We also know that the families and children of female offenders are more likely to go off the rails and offend themselves if their mothers are jailed miles away from home. This turns into a vicious circle, affecting future generations, and it does nothing to address reoffending behaviour. So we need to ensure that our women's links to the family and community can be maintained at the same time as she's taking part in targeted work to address that specific issue which is fueling her offending behaviour. On Monday, Presiding Officer, I spent a few hours with the women and staff at the 218 Centre in Glasgow. And I know that other members in this chamber have done so over the years since that facility was established. Whilst the 218 Centre is an entirely voluntary approach, it provides exactly the type of sophisticated approach which I would like to see as part of our plans for the future way in which we look at dealing with women in custody. I was struck by how honest the women were about how tough it actually is to stick with a residential rehabilitation centre like 218 rather than to spend time in prison. It is definitely not a soft option. It's hard work to be honest with yourself and finally ask for and take the help you need in order to deal with the issues and problems you may have. Deep-seated issues like substance misuse, trauma, bereavement, physical and sexual abuse and low self-esteem that can so often be a woman's way to offending. Dame Eilish's commission said that, and I quote, many of its recommendations could be achieved through reconfiguration of existing funding rather than significant new investment. But we as a government recognise that it might be difficult for partners to be able to reconfigure their service delivery for women quickly. That's why we've been working with local community justice partners and we've invested £3 million since 2013 to 2015 to allow this reconfiguration of existing services to take place. This has allowed us to support some 16 projects delivering new or enhanced services for women offenders in communities across the country. The Scottish Government funding has allowed local partners some headroom to reconfigure their service in a way that was felt could meet the aspirations of the Commission and would provide the best outcomes for women in their localities, and crucially, at a level which they were sure to be able to continue to sustain beyond the time of the limited Scottish Government funding. In Glasgow, Edinburgh and Aberdeen, we have worked with partners to establish justice centres for women. These centres provide a multi-agency service and a holistic response to women who offend. The centres not only have a specific central location, but also a network of activities and services operating from that base. The staff work proactively to support the women involved in the service. And I recently visited the new centre in Glasgow, Tomorrow's Women Glasgow. This is a new coordinated service for women with local justice health partners have developed to work alongside existing services for women in the city, such as at the 218 centre. And I was struck by the multi-agency approach to working with women and the clear commitment of all of the staff that they had to provide the right support and help to support those women who required their assistance to turn their lives around. And I also spoke to some of the women who use the centre, and I'm sure, just like the women at the 218 centre, they told me how much of a difference it is making to them in being able to address their offending behaviour. Our funding has also helped services such as the Willow Centre in Edinburgh, the Aberdeen Women's Justice Centre to secure new fit-for-purpose facilities and to expand their activities and to increase availability of services to women in the area. Some of the projects that have been created, for example, in Dundee, have been through the Criminal Justice Social Work Provision in North Lanarkshire, Renfrewshire, Highland Region, all taking approaches which they believe could enhance the way in which they deal with women offenders within their locality. In Fife and Angus, South Lanarkshire, and Falkirk and Forth Valley, partners are testing an outreach model to engage and deliver services to women in communities where they live rather than based in single locations. And the evaluations of the approach that they are taking will be undertaken in order to identify the most effective approach in these models. I'll give way to the member.
Councillor Dugdale.
I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's remarks around evaluation. Can he tell us, in response to the question I had in my opening speech, whether he's examined the financial viability of these projects continuing past March this year?
Cabinet Secretary, you're approaching your last.
That work is ongoing at the present time with my officials and these different projects to look at that. And part of the agreement with the funding which they received 2 years ago was the sustainability of the project to allow the reconfiguration of the existing services to take place, and we are working with them to make sure that takes place. As I've already made clear to the Chamber, Presiding Officer, I'm determined to reduce the female prison population and to have more women doing the tough work that they need to turn their lives around in the community. That's why I'm announcing today that we will be investing an additional £1.5 million in 2015-16 to support community-based provision for women offenders. The course that I have set opens up the potential for greater use of community-based solutions for women who offend and women who are at risk of offending. This will be to the benefit of us all. By dealing appropriately and effectively with this vulnerable group of women, Scotland will be a safer place.
Thank you very much. I now call in Margaret Mitchell to speak to and move Amendment 12160.3, 6 minutes or so.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate Labour for bringing the issue of women offenders to the Chamber today. Whilst I'm sympathetic to the intent behind the motion, I believe it misses the mark in terms of focusing on the issues that have to be clarified and resolved if we are not to find ourselves in the same situation many months or even years from now of still pursuing an unrealised Angelini-type strategy to deal with this vexing problem. I also acknowledge and pay tribute to the Cabinet Secretary for being prepared, even at this late stage, to reverse the plans for HMP Inverclyde. But questions must be asked as to why this decision was taken in the first place to commission Inverclyde and why only at this late stage it's been reversed after a staggering £7.8 million had been spent on the proposal. This at a time when budgets are being squeezed across the board, this represents a significant dent in the public purse, resulting in a back to the drawing board outcome and yet more uncertainty about the way forward. Whilst the government has recognised the need for a national women's prison, I note that the Labour motion fails to mention this, although Kezia Dugdale did clarify her position in her speech. But I think it's worth taking a moment to set out why this is needed. In the first place, women are not a different category to male offenders, purely because of their gender, but rather, as Dame Eilish emphasised, because there is a need to address the distinct features and characteristics of female offending. Secondly, there is no doubt there are dangerous and even evil women, just as there are men who fall into this category. Yesterday was Holocaust Memorial Day. Also, it marked 70 years since the liberation of Auschwitz, where approximately 1 million Jews were exterminated. There is a chilling reminder here that some of the cruelest and most feared guards in Auschwitz were, in fact, women. Decades later, today within the United Kingdom, there is also a clear and present danger resulting from a known increase in the number of women terrorists who are joining Islamic State. Women not just perfectly prepared, but fully committed to carrying out the most evil atrocities. And in addition to this, from my teaching experience in a previous life, I found a disruptive female pupil could be much more problematic than a male pupil. In other words, in devising and delivering the best way forward to tackle female offending, it's crucial that in sympathising and seeking to put in place the most effective treatment for the vast majority of women prisoners, we avoid the temptation to look at this issue through rose-tinted glasses. Instead, there is a need for a forensic and realistic assessment of the risk that women offenders present, acknowledging that some, albeit a very small percentage of the female offender population, by nature of their crimes, will require a prison sentence for the protection of the public. So in order for this debate to be of tangible value, what we want to hear today is a clear indication of precisely how the government intends to move forward, including what provision is being made for the 218-type centres, which tackle the higher lifetime incidences of severe and repeated physical and sexual victimisation, higher rates of poor mental health, a great tendency to self-harm, all of which are recognised as distinguishing features of women offenders. Here, the evidence from judges, including sheriffs, makes it perfectly clear that the value of having 218-type centres as a disposal, and therefore they support many more of these centres being as available as an option for sentencing. Depressingly, instead of the distinct commitment to 218 type centres as an explanation of how these are going to be resourced and financed, the government has merely stated that the Scottish Prison Service will now undertake a period of extension engagement with key partners. Also, community services or disposals have been mentioned, but not of the 218 type precisely, and I think this is the key to it. And this is after the Equal Opportunities Committee conducted an inquiry into female offenders in the criminal justice system in 2008. It's after the Commission on Women Offenders, led by the former Lord Advocate, Dame Eilish Angelini, published its comprehensive recommendations on women offending in 2012, after consulting with over 100 individuals and organisations. In other words, 7 years later, unless there is some meat on the bones and concrete proposal, it looks very much like we're back to square one once again. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, rather than vague statements and funding about community projects not really specified out, it's important and imperative that statements, though, about service workers working collaboratively with the criminal justice system don't remain just statements, but instead there is a clear indication of how the 218 type centres, in line with the constructive proposals outlined in the Angelini report, will be funded and established. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. And I now call on Alison McInnes to speak to and move Amendment 12160.1. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm so pleased the Cabinet Secretary reflected upon the plan for HMP Inverclyde and listened to the progressive voices raised against it. The Howard League, Families Outside and many more across Civic Scotland played an important role in securing this outcome. His decision has presented us with another opportunity to do things differently, to redefine the experiences of women who come into contact with our justice system in the future. In responding to the Angelini report almost 3 years ago, Kenny McCaskill said, "How women are dealt with in the criminal justice system is one of the most pressing social justice issues in recent times." I agreed then, and I agree now. What dismays me is how faltering the progress has been in the interim. So efforts must now be redoubled to bring about the radical and a more ambitious approach that the Cabinet Secretary has talked about today. I have long campaigned for that, and the Scottish Liberal Democrats will offer steadfast support if the government is up for such radical change. I think we should take a moment to praise the staff at the Scottish Prison Service who were tasked with delivering HMP Inverclyde. Led by Kate Donegan, a former governor of Cornton Vale, they had to operate within the constraints set by the Scottish Government at that time. It was evident that they worked extremely hard to ensure the facility was as sympathetic as possible to the needs of women offenders, and I am certain that much of their enlightened thinking could be usefully adopted elsewhere in the prison estate. However, I agree that the fundamental plan for the prison of this size and this location was too significant a departure from the Angelini report. Building to meet projections only risks entrenching the mistakes of the past. The Commission on Women Offenders made scores of recommendations. I ask the Cabinet Secretary to end the fragmented approach to their implementation today and to commit to implementing the package in the round. It really is the radical, ambitious and sophisticated programme that he's mentioned and is seeking. Many of the reforms are complementary. They require a multi-agency holistic response, and the Cabinet Secretary will therefore need health boards, local authorities, the judiciary and many more to buy into this vision. And that brings me on to my amendment. The current lack of diversity among Scotland's judiciary is indefensible, and I feel that this has contributed to serious failings in the sentencing of women. The Judicial Appointments Board diversity strategy acknowledges that the composition of the judiciary must reflect the diversity of society, and I quote, "A judiciary whose members are drawn from a wide range of backgrounds and life experiences will bring varying perspectives on legal issues and is likely to enhance public confidence." But the statistics reveal a different story. Just 9 of the 34 senators of the College of Justice are women. Only 30 of 139 sheriffs sitting on the benches, and 1 of the 6 sheriff principals are women. Indeed, Scotland is amongst the worst in Europe when it comes to equality amongst the judiciary. Last October, the Council of Europe reported that of the 47 Council members, only Azerbaijan had a worse gender balance. In contrast, around Europe, the gender balance is almost equal. In fact, in France, Spain, Italy, Holland, Finland and Denmark, the majority of judges are female. It cannot be that only in Scotland such a small number of women are able enough, experienced enough to sit on our benches. So why is the number of women in the eligible pool increasing faster than the number of applications for judicial office from women? Presiding officer, when only a third of women remanded in custody go on to receive a custodial sentence, when in 2011-12 four-fifths were serving sentences of 6 months or less, when the number of women convicted of a crime has gone up by 14% in the last 10 years, but the number in custody has more than doubled, yet all the while the gravity of offending has remained the same, we are surely compelled to consider how the judiciary can better utilise the disposals available. How can we ensure judges have greater confidence in community-based services and innovative approaches such as restorative justice? The Commission on Women Offenders identified that there was scope to expand the breadth, depth and regularity of the training regarding sentencing. The Scottish Sentencing Council could make a difference by promoting understanding and consistency in sentencing practice. The Lord Justice Clerk, Lord Carloway, believes the Council can generate a shift from punishment to rehabilitation. He suggested, and I quote, "It will advance Scotland into a more civilised era where retribution, other than in relation to the most serious of crimes, will have a smaller plate at the sentencing table." Presiding officer, reducing the size of the prison population, reducing the number of people held on remand, ending senseless short-term sentences, they all hinge on sentencing policy. And yet the Council still hasn't been established 4 years after the Parliament legislated for it. At the heart of improving the situation for every woman who comes into contact with Scotland's justice system is the need to break down such barriers, overcome misconceptions and increase understanding. This is the only way to ensure that sentencing is focused on rehabilitation and addresses the specific distinct needs of women. Presiding officer, I move my amendment.
Many thanks. We now turn to the open debate. We don't have an awful lot of time available. Speeches of 6 minutes, please. Roderick Campbell, to be followed by Elaine Murray.
So, like others, I welcomed the Cabinet Secretary's statement on Monday, and indeed I also welcomed his very considered response to the Justice Committee on the 16th of December. The Chamber may recall that he said to the committee at that stage, "I intend to take the opportunity to understand all the different aspects that feed into our thinking about the future shape of that facility before any final decision is made on the matter. That will include looking at its size as well as the model and the approach that we will choose." This was not the decision taken overnight. I've also taken the opportunity to remind myself of the contents of the Angelini report itself. Its section on prisons highlighted the inadequacies of Caunton Vale and called for its replacement with a smaller specialist prison for long-term offenders. It drew attention to successes such as the Community Integration Unit at the then Aberdeen HMP and the 218 Centre in Glasgow, which is highlighted as an example of good practice and which we've heard a lot about already today. Recommendation 227 made it clear that additional places for women offenders should be provided in local prisons to enable improved community integration and family contact and supported accommodation as an alternative to custody and to support women on release. Alternatives to remand and to prosecution were highlighted by the report, together with a commitment to community justice centres. And as the Cabinet Secretary has already mentioned, most importantly, it was stated that many of the recommendations could be achieved through reconfiguration of existing funding rather than significant new investment. In June 2012, the then Cabinet Secretary, in his response to Dame Eilish, envisaged that HMP Inverclyde, not then designated solely for women, would accommodate 52 women plus a further 5 in a community integration unit. In addition, he accepted the need for pilot schemes for community justice centres. Following on that, the Scottish Prison Service embarked on a consultation in August 2012. One of the matters highlighted by the response to that consultation was that there was strong support for regional units for women on remand or serving short sentences, as well as a debate about the best place for a new national prison. Presiding officer, along the way, we've perhaps become too focused on the building to replace Caunton Vale as a national prison, on the bricks and mortar rather than on the underlying issues. I'm pleased that we're now exploring a more local approach. maintaining family and community links wherever possible, while tackling underlying issues such as alcohol, drugs and mental health, must be the way forward. And there can be no doubt that ease of access for those serving any form of custodial sentence or punishment is important. That will allow contact between mothers and their families wherever possible. Of course, it may also have a preventative purpose, as approximately 30% of children with mothers in prison will develop mental health problems. There is, of course, a higher risk of those children also ending up in prison. In evidence to the Justice Committee on the 26th of June 2012, Dame Eilish also highlighted the importance of mentoring as critical to successfully keeping women out of prison. This is something that this government has embraced fully through the SHINE mentoring service in particular, delivered through a public social partnership and continuing to be funded along with other mentoring services through the Reducing Reoffending Fund that will be worth £18 million over the five-year period to 2017. Those women who have experience of mentoring projects have responded positively. Former prisoners have responded positively to the difference mentoring can make. Mentors may be role models that fulfil a role that social workers simply cannot. And indeed, in some cases, former mentees become mentors. And in relation to community reintegration, the new prison at HMP Grampian will hopefully build on previous experience at HMP Aberdeen and HMP Inverness. For offenders completing custodial sentences, we need to recognise the importance of reintegration. Through care support is vital, of course. Statutory through care is limited. Extending that fully to short-term offenders is important. And let's also remember that in October 2013, a ministerial group for offender reintegration was established to assist integration between the criminal justice system and wider public services. Trials such as those conducted at HMP Perth that seek to maintain tenancies in existing homes for short-term offenders to help those offenders in reintegrating into the community after release are important. The position in relation to community justice is, of course, still a work in progress. But with a fully integrated community planning partnership, with a focus on reducing reoffending and alternatives to custody, there are grounds for optimism. I am pleased that the Cabinet Secretary still plans to close the existing Caunton Vale facility, but I share his preference for possibly building a smaller prison on that site. There, of course, remains a decision, as I said, about where to focus a secure facility for the small cohort of the most dangerous offenders. That, of course, is a matter which will need to be consulted on further. But in relation to community justice centres generally, I accept that in a diverse country of city, small town, village and country, a uniform system may not be feasible. And indeed, it was something that Dame Eilish accepted when she gave evidence in June 2012. With projects currently underway in Angus and Fife, for example, we already recognise this. And I await with interest the independent evaluation of the 16 projects funded by the government. But I also welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment today to £1.5 million for community-based solutions. That's clearly a step forward. Presiding Officer, this is a Cabinet Secretary that listens to interested parties, that takes on board the comments of the Howard League and others. The aim must be, however, to reduce the numbers of women in prison wherever possible, to reduce numbers on remand, to look critically at any short sentence, and to redouble efforts to reduce reoffending. As a society, rising numbers of women in prison is not a sign of success. I'm pleased that that trend has stalled and that numbers are now dropping, albeit in a small way.
I'm afraid you must close.
Scotland please. Can do better. Indeed, it must do better. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. Elaine Murray, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Like other speakers today and the organisations which have been campaigning for a rethink on the proposed female prison at Inverclyde, I very much welcome the Cabinet Secretary's statement, and like Roddy Campbell, I pay tribute to the fact that the Cabinet Secretary did say to the Justice Committee on 16 December last year that he intended to understand all the different aspects of the issues before he took the final decisions, so I'm pleased that he has done so. Previously, the Scottish Government had stated that it accepted 33 of the 32 recommendations of the Angelini Commission. However, her principal recommendation that HMP Caunton Vale should be replaced by a smaller specialist prison for female offenders who were serving a statutory long-term sentences and those who presented a significant risk to the public was not really followed either in the spirit or in the letter. The statistics on female offenders speak for themselves. 14% of crimes were committed by women in 2012-13. However, the vast majority of those offences were minor, and overall, women are less likely to receive a custodial sentence than men. Less than 6% of the prison population are women. However, three quarters of those who are serving a custodial sentence are serving 6 months or less. And of the female population, one quarter are women on remand, a figure which has doubled in the last 10 years. These are women and girls not yet found guilty of any offence. And shockingly, only 30% of these women held in prison on remand actually go on to serve a custodial sentence. More than one in six women held in prison on remand should not be there at all, as the crimes of which they are accused do not merit a custodial sentence. Women removed from their homes, their families, their children, placed in prison, accused of a crime which is not punishable by imprisonment, and that cannot be right. As Stuart Stevenson indicated, four-fifths of the female prison population have mental health problems, 60% were under the influence of drugs, and 40% under the influence of alcohol at the time of their offence. 84% were unemployed at the time of their offence, and 71% have no formal qualifications. Compare that to the 15% of the general population. Over half have experienced domestic abuse, and one-third are the victims of sexual abuse. Almost four out of five women offenders also show evidence of impulsive and risk-taking behaviour. Recent studies, including those of male prisoners, also indicate that these behaviours may result from brain injuries, particularly those acquired in childhood. It's not, of course, just the women themselves who are affected. Two-thirds of the women in prison have children. Indeed, across Scotland, 27,000 children annually are affected by their parents' imprisonment. But although two-thirds of women prisoners have children, only 4 in 10 receive visits. And prison visiting is a particular problem where women are imprisoned far from home and when public transport links are poor. And that was one of my concerns about the configuration previously proposed with a large prison in Inverclyde and hubs in Edinburgh and Grampian. Prison visiting would not be easy for families from Dumfries and Galloway, for example. HMP Dumfries used to take local women offenders when it was a young offenders institution, but actually there were insufficient numbers to be able to offer women an effective programme of education and work. In fact, on one occasion when I visited HMP Dumfries, there was only one woman there, and that was clearly a very unsatisfactory situation for her, so there needs to be examination of how we treat different parts of the country. The Angelini Commission stated that it was convinced that there needed to be a new approach to the management of women in Scotland's prison. And we know that very short prison sentences are often ineffective in addressing the causes of offending. Alternatives to imprisonment, to remand and to prosecution need to be developed, which, yes, challenge offending behaviour, but also provide support to deal with the underlying issues which result in offending, mental health problems, addiction and so on. The Angelini Commission, as we've said already, recommended investment in community justice centres to provide intensive interventions which would be available at every stage of the criminal justice system. Attendance could be a condition for diversion from prosecution, a condition of bail, or a condition of release from prison. Offenders would be supervised and managed and would be able to draw on support from a variety of agencies and services on mental health, debt management, employment, housing, childcare and benefits. Community justice centres can coordinate alternatives to prosecution, such as early intervention with young offenders, fiscal work of orders or composite diversion orders. But, as others have said, support needs to be made available for female offenders right across Scotland, including in rural communities. And that does mean sustainable funding for other support models too. So I too am pleased to hear the Cabinet Secretary's announcement today of £1.5 million in the next financial year. Women often end up in remand because they have broken their bail conditions, and this should be tackled by better supervision of bail. Monitoring and supervision of bail actually has decreased. In contrast, if we look at Sweden, they have introduced some time ago an intensive supervision sentence of up to 6 months, which is served at home on an electronic tag. It's indeed a form of house arrest, but the women are allowed out for time for employment, training, healthcare and rehabilitation. So they're actually getting those other services as well. And I think we need to look at some of the international examples of good practice of alternatives to imprisonment. In conclusion, cancelling the prison contract is a welcome first step, but we do have a long way to go in developing the sorts of information which keep women out of prison and which work right across Scotland, urban and rural Scotland. Diversion from crime and prevention are, of course, the most preferable, but interventions are needed at all stages of the criminal justice system.
Many thanks. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Mary Fee, 6 minutes or thereby.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I first want to commend Alison McInnes, not just for her very measured and thoughtful speech in the Chamber today, but because she has single-handedly kept the focus on the Eilish Angelini Commission and whether or not it was delivering. She's not been opportunistic. She has fought this in and out, and I know this not just in the Chamber, but in committee. I have to say that I'm glad that certain members are now visiting the 218 project, which again, we're not joined at the hip, Alison McInnes and me, but we were at it a long time ago. It is tough love. There are people who regress who go on that course. The problem, I would say, you've mentioned electronic tagging, is these women are supervised, that even with electronic tagging, it's not an all solution because they can lapse. So it's very tough, and it is. But again, as someone has already said, it can only take 12 people at a time, residential, over months. So it is intensive, but it is an excellent facility. But I do get a bit tetchy when I've been told the blooming obvious in here that some of us have known for a very long time about the number of women offenders, the percentage, in fact, that are for minor offences are on remand, who are victims. We've known that for a long time. Many people in prison, not just women, are victims themselves. But I want to give some background. So I want to lay something. On the 5th of August 2014, Colin McConnell and the then Cabinet Secretary came before the Justice Committee to develop their then plans for Inverclyde, as it were, as a more immediate solution to the impressing problems with Cotton Vale. And I want to agree with Alan. I'm going to agree with you again, Alison McInnes. I don't know if this is destroying your career. But Kate Donoghue as well, a reforming person. Colin McConnell is a reformer. I've got a lot of time for him. And while they may or may not have been constrained by the previous Cabinet Secretary, they certainly weren't developing what I recognise, and this is what I object to the term, super prison, like an Alcatraz. It was to be nothing like that. It was to be more like a community that was to put people in there so they could wander about, they would have some sense of ordinary life and be supported. Whether or not it was the right thing, it was never an Alcatraz. So let's get away from this idea it was a super prison. It was to be a holistic approach to the care and management of women. Of course we had concerns about local access. And this was raised by members across the committee. Yes,
It's the point, not it wasn't in line with the Eilish Angelini recommendations, fully debated, and it wasn't the way forward. How on earth did we get into that position?
See, to Margaret, I'm going back, Mitchell, I'm going back to the committee. None of us thought it was perfect, but I don't recall anybody aggressively opposing it. We had huge reservations about local access. I can remember questions being raised by Elaine Murray, quite reasonably, and myself, about the south of Scotland, by yourself, Margaret Mitchell, with regard to local access. But I remember the tenor of that within the committee being, well, if this is what's on offer, let's sort it out, let's get the local stuff sorted out, and let's get the people who are really difficult inside it. There was not aggressive opposition at that time. Now, I know in committees it's a very different mood from in the chamber, which is more confrontational. That's not right for committees, but I just want to put that on the record. Of course, I am welcome in this turnaround. And I have to say, it's been very difficult for members in here over years. I know that Richard Simpson did an excellent report called A Better Way, 2002, about, and one of the recommendations, shifting the culture towards rehabilitation and treatment. Not your fault it didn't happen entirely. Jim Wallace was also Justice Minister at the time, Labour and Liberal in power for 8 years. We didn't manage it. I actually think this is the first time in this chamber we're actually grasping the thistle of saying, this must be done. This particular group of people deserve a different way of dealing with them. And once we have done that, we may then be able to move on to other people within the criminal justice system, young offenders who may also be victims and need support. So I welcome this move by the government. I don't want to see it as a political football because I've been here too long seeing good people in different parties trying to change this around. And now it's about to happen. Let's do it. And let's give credit to the Cabinet Secretary 1 month in post who took this and said, I'm changing it. Now, it's not an easy solution. As Alison McInnes, my goodness, I think that's four times I've mentioned her. As Alison McInnes said quite rightly, we have to look at sentencing. We have to look at judicial training. We have to look at resources, having the right people in the right place. Of course, it's important that people maintain the rented accommodation. One of the first things we heard at 218 was that somebody met the woman coming out of prison, got her in a taxi and took her somewhere so she wasn't standing outside with nowhere to go. And the second thing they did was made sure that Glasgow City Council kept the rented accommodation open for that. It's simple, practical things. It's difficult, and sometimes the public will not be on our side. Sometimes the public will not be on our side if they see someone who's been in prison or who's not been put into prison getting a helping hand in society, and they'll say, why are they getting that and not a member of my family? This is where the Parliament must show leadership. It must show leadership and show that these women and their families and their children are victims in the main. There are some really bad people. They will have to be imprisoned in a national facility for the protection of society. But most of these women are more of a danger to themselves than to society at large. And I very much welcome this. And I do hope that I'm not going to see headlines again in the paper that make it difficult for people like me to be consensual when that's what we want to be in our hearts.
Many thanks. Now calling Mary Fee to be followed by Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating the Cabinet Secretary for taking the decision not to go ahead with the proposed women's prison in Inverclyde? We need radical change in how we deal with women offenders, more use of community intervention and rehabilitation, and less focus on incarceration. And in prior justice debates, I've referenced the practices used by other countries in tackling imprisonment, such as our Scandinavian neighbours. And with that being said, it doesn't mean we're soft in crime. Where someone, male or female, is a danger to society, then they must be dealt with by the rule of law and society must be protected. However, many prisoners don't need custodial sentences. They need help and their families need support. And as a Cabinet Secretary will know, I'm convener of the cross-party group on families affected by imprisonment. And the Cabinet Secretary's predecessor took a keen interest in the cross-party group, and I hope the new Cabinet Secretary will do the same. The Labour motion refers to the Commission on Women Offenders as a clear roadmap to tackling women's offending. However, since Dame Angelini presented the Commission's findings almost 3 years ago, it is disappointing that we have not made more progress. However, I do look forward to the renewed impetus that the new Cabinet Secretary has brought to this issue. Women's offending has become an increasing focus as the female prison population has doubled in the last decade. The greater attention on female offending is justified, and I have read criticism in the last week or two from people who believe that imprisonment shouldn't be looked at in the spectrum of gender. However, we know, as the Commission states, that while many women experience similar backgrounds and health problems to men, there is a great disparity in the problems that find women in prison, and the experiences within are vastly different. Women are more likely than men to be imprisoned for dishonesty offences, such as shoplifting and theft, more likely to be remanded in custody, have higher rates of mental health problems, have histories of physical and sexual abuse, be victims themselves, and very importantly, have dependent children. Research has shown that children of imprisoned parents are more likely to end up in prison themselves. So any work to reduce offending just now is preventative for future generations. Around 27,000 children are affected by parental imprisonment each year, and around two-thirds of women in prison have children. And this is only an estimate, as no extensive work has been undertaken to identify these children. And one solution would be to ensure that family and child impact assessments are carried out at the point of sentencing, ensuring that the relevant authorities... Yes, certainly.
Does the member may recall Dame Eilish giving evidence to the Justice Committee in June 2012 on child impact assessments, saying that she didn't believe that any judge who sentenced without reference to the fact that someone had children and the impact that imprisonment would have would be doing their job appropriately. She also believed that creating more bureaucracy and more reports would not necessarily make a difference to the sentencing process. Does
the member disagree with Dame Eilish on that point?
Mary Fee.
I take the point the member has said. The point I'm trying to make is that the Child and Family Impact Assessment should be at front and centre of decisions that are taken. I absolutely accept that they already are done, but I think in some cases they are almost done as an afterthought. Yes, we've done that. There needs to be more importance and pressure put on courts to take into account the work that's done through the impact assessment. And it would also mean that relevant authorities would be informed and would liaise with one another in relation to the impact assessment. And in addition, children of prisoners should be considered an at-risk group, as looked after children are, enabling additional learning support for these children. And during the passage of the Children and Young People's Bill, I tried to pass amendments that would have had this effect. Unfortunately, it didn't gain the support of the government. These amendments would have made a substantial difference to the lives of many children. Changing how we think about imprisonment will not only save the public purse now and in the future, it will protect the next generation and those after from the rates of re-offending we see now. Figures from criminal justice show 43% of women leaving prison are reconvicted within a year, compared to 30% of all prisoners. And a lot has already been said about the 218 Project in Glasgow and other community-based initiatives across Scotland that care for women. These are excellent projects that help troubled and fractured women find the right way forward. Far too often I hear of women and men going to prison not receiving the correct medical, mental and supportive assistance they need. When their sentence is up, they find themselves back in the same community and the environment that landed them in prison in the first place. I visited the 218 Project, as have many members, and in my view it's the right way forward for many women in the criminal justice system, women who are at greater risk if we don't help them. Many dependent children lie in the state as the guardian of the imprisoned to help their mothers and fathers get the right treatment they require in order to have a normal family life that all in society want for their children. When a father is sent to prison, children often have their mother and can live in the family home, albeit under difficult circumstances. But when a mother finds herself in prison, we know the children are more likely to end up with another relative or in care instead of with the father. And finally, Presiding Officer, can I repeat my support for the Scottish Government's decision to look to smaller community-based solutions to imprisonment? And I will be happy to work with MSPs across the Chamber to get the best solution for Scotland and her justice system.
Many thanks. And I now call on Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And let me start by congratulating Kezia Dugdale on basically a broadly drawn and generally well-argued case. Disagreement in detail, but that's the nature of debate. Certainly agreeing on the broad thrust. Slightly disappointed that Roman didn't come up until 12 minutes into her 40-minute speech, but it's been dealt with by Elaine Murray, and I very much welcome that. Now, like others, I've been to the 218 Centre as well. It was probably more than 10 years ago when I did it, and I went there with Pauline McNeill, who is a Labour MSP, thus indicating a willingness and an ability for us to work together in here. And at the risk of damaging Richard Simpson's political career forever, I think we worked very effectively when we were dealing with the issue of Peterhead Prison. And indeed, I used to take him away from his officials for secret coffee rendezvous where we would... You see, he's covering his face, not in shame, because he did well on the subject, but we can work together on this, and I very much welcome the tone of the debate so far. One of the things that hasn't come up in the debate, which I think might usefully be added for consideration afterwards, that there is very clear in prisons that there are huge literacy and numeracy issues. Now, I genuinely don't know if this is a particular gender issue, but it's certainly in smaller units, as we would expect to see women, there ought to be greater opportunity for dealing with that. And I hope that in looking... Oh, Dr. Simpson?
An intervention, just a couple of facts. Numeracy, last survey, 2013, women, 22% had numeracy problems, 11% had reading problems, 13% had writing problems. And it's not that dissimilar for men.
Right. Well, I'm very grateful for that, which confirms I'm more familiar with male prisoners because, of course, I had the sex offenders unit in my constituency and was a regular visitor to people who were probably my constituents in there. But in particular, I think that's something we need to add to the mix of things that we look at. Now, it's very interesting to visit a range of prisons, and in session two, when I was shadow deputy justice minister with responsibility for prisons and drug policy, I visited quite a lot. I visited the state hospital at Carstair. We've touched on the issues of mental health. Fortunately, that seems not to be quite an issue for women. I visited with my wife the prison's women's unit at Porterfield Prison in Inverness. And my wife, coming to this absolutely fresh, was extremely impressed by the care and attention that was given by the staff in there in what were absolutely far from ideal physical arrangements. And it was a small unit at the time we were there. I think there were six prisoners there. I visited La Bapaume, northeast of Paris, to get comparative information for the Peterhead campaign. Very impressed by what they were doing for women there. They had a call centre, that women were being trained to work in call centres. They had a manufacturing unit where they were making mats for children. And the women also had a mother and baby unit in there. And the presence of some children under the age of two seemed to have a very significant moderating effect on behaviour among those who were in that prison. But that's an issue that has to be considered very, very carefully, because the children need to be protected from the effects of imprisonment. But it seemed to work there. And of course, in HMP Grampian, I visited shortly after the first women prisoners came to HMP Grampian, and they were very enthusiastic about the physical environment. They had not at that stage got particularly engaged in the rehabilitation environment, so I don't speak to that. And they even said the food was good and invited me to join them for lunch. But alas, another appointment took me away. Now, it's interesting. We've talked about numbers, and it just happened as part of a private project. I was looking at convictions in St Andrew's Court between 1889 and 1899. I have an interest in genealogy, and that took me there. And exactly as today, the convictions, 5% of them were women. Nothing has changed in 125 years. And I just thought that was really quite interesting. And when I look at the English figures, the Ministry of Justice shows that the proportion is broadly the same in England. So even though they've rather different policies in a certain regard. And when Jim Wallace made a statement to Parliament in September 2002, he was being questioned about the failure to reduce the number of women prisoners. So it's a long, long-run prison issue. That I hope the Minister will uniquely manage to make a real difference, and he's made a real step change difference by changing the policy here. Oh, and indeed, the Minister in 2002 was being criticised for a 28% increase in remand prisoners, which was not really well understood, and Cathy Peaty was raising the issue of overcrowding at Cornton Vale. So I think we've made a good start when we reset policy in relation to women offenders. We do a good thing, not just for the offenders, but for Scotland as a whole, because if we reset it to get the focus on piloting new ways of rehabilitating people, addressing mental health issues, as the government's motion makes the play of, and talking about dialogue with all parties, I think we're in a good place. I congratulate Labour for bringing this motion to Parliament.
Thank you very much. I now call on Christina McKelvey, to be followed by Jane Baxter.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. A very famous female offender once said these words: "Who were the women who day by day trod the very stones in which my feet now stood? How and why had they broken the law? In what way were they enemies of society? Child-burdened women who were left without money, without the means or opportunity or physical power to earn it. Who had stolen in order to save their lives and that of their children? Women who from their childhood had been trained to physical shame. If such women become sodden, by drink, undermined by drug taking, what hope is there of a cure of imprisonment? Presiding officer, that was Emily Pankhurst in 1908 when she was imprisoned for her valiant campaign to gain votes for women. And over 100 years on, we've heard many testimonies this afternoon of how, for women, that's not changed. So for me, the very welcome decision of the Cabinet Secretary is not just about bricks and mortar, it's about a fundamental shift in penal policy. Justice is, of course, a wider question than prisons and prisoners. It encompasses gender justice, which many of my colleagues have spoken about today, men and women being treated by the courts in a consistent way. How our courts and how our prison service deal with women offenders cannot ignore gender. How women who are given custodial sentences are managed will be different from men. This Scottish Government has already committed substantial funds to building a better prison system for all, and the £1.5 million announced by the Cabinet Secretary today is testament to that continued commitment. The carefully thought-out decision not to proceed with a new women's prison in Inverclyde is welcome news, and I'm glad that Michael Matheson took enough time to fully consider the information he had available. He has, after all, been in post since the 21st of November, so it was clearly a great priority to him. During a visit to the 218 Centre, the Cabinet Secretary stated that the current plans do not fit his vision, and he reiterated that today. Many groups and individuals, like the Howard League, like Sir Optimist International with their Transforming Lives report, like Elaine Smith MSP and Margaret Mitchell MSP and Alison McInnes MSP and myself on the Equal Opportunities Committee, have been working on this issue for years. So it is truly something that we can all stand together on. And that's integrity. And that integrity that we need is that integrity and that policy is what these women need. So the Scottish Government, the Scottish Prison Service, will now undertake a period of extensive engagement with key partners. And believe me, Cabinet Secretary, those key partners have already been on the phone emailing me saying, how can we get involved? I'm sure they'll be doing the same with you. And that view to investing in smaller regional and community-based custodial facilities across the country is something that we all strive for. This will involve looking at other international models of best practice, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary has his eyes firmly fixed in Finland when he thinks about that. As Dame Eilish Angelini QC made clear in her report, women commit different types of crimes for distinctively different reasons. Drug abuse, a dysfunctional or deprived family background, mental illness, being victims of violence themselves, and sometimes confused desperation all colour their motives. She points out that while the proportions of male and female populations in prison for violent offences are similar, proportionally more women are in prison for other crimes, such as drug-related crimes and crimes against public justice, 29% compared to 21%, and dishonesty, 19% compared to 12%. The consequences for women who go to prison also differ, and we heard a great testimony from Mary Fee on that today. They are more likely to lose custody of their children and to end up leaving prison homeless. All of which indicates how right Dame Eilish is in her recommendations. We need the one-stop shops based on the 218 service, definitely, and support organisations like Circle, who are a great organisation in Hamilton, who do fantastic work. We need a suite of services that meet the needs of women and geography as well. First of all, they work. And second, these kind of small facilities for around 12 people allow them to access a consistent range of services to reduce reoffending and change behaviour. Presiding officer, I don't have time to go through all the recommendations today. I believe all of my colleagues across the chamber have touched on many, many areas that we can all strive to achieve. But the crucial thing is we have to look at those recommendations. So I will close with some information from the Howard League in Scotland, who I know have informed us all in all of these debates for many years. They have strongly welcomed the decision, with John Scott QC convener describing it as bold. Bit civil service speak, but we'll accept it, bold and brave maybe. And underlining the importance of Dame Angelini's report, Mr. Smith Scott also points out, most women in prison in Scotland today have complex needs that relate to their social circumstances, previous histories of abuse and mental health and addiction problems. The report stated unequivocally that most women who have offended do not need to be in prison. And I believe I have used the phrase in here that some women who are in prison need a hospital bed rather than a prison cell. The impact of imprisonment on women and their families is often catastrophic. It is for that reason that the report recommended that Cortonville be closed and replaced with a smaller specialist unit. It is clear that the government wants to move forward, Presiding Officer, with innovative responses that the Cabinet Secretary is determined to seek out more effective and meaningful way forward in the current system. This is good government, and it's good government with an integrity, and I think if we can all work together in the way that we've expressed our support for this over the next few months, I'm sure we can realise that change that is really, really needed. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I now call on Jane Baxter to be followed by Gil Paterson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When the Angelini report was published, the then Justice Secretary, Kenny McCaskill, called it a compelling vision for the future. The centrepiece of that report was that Cornton Vale should not be the place for the like-for-like facility, but that a new approach should be taken, moving away from retribution and imprisonment to a focus on female-specific needs and rehabilitation, and this in practice would be manifested by the creation of a new, smaller, specialist prison for long-term prisoners and those who present a significant risk to the public. And this change would be rooted in a focus on what is right and what works, rooted in an understanding of the comparatively low risks posed to society by women offenders and of what drives women's offending and re-offending. There is an abundance of evidence that imprisoning women achieves little. In this country, 3/4 of custodial sentences imposed on women are for 6 months or less, but short prison sentences demonstrably do not reduce re-offending in women. Okay, yep.
Christine McKelvey.
I thank the member very much for taking the intervention, and she'll know, like me, that 3/4 of the women sent to jail are for 6 months or less, and in 2008 the McLeish Commission suggested that there should be a presumption against that. Would the member support that aim?
Yes. To put it briefly, yes. The statistics show that 70% of women offenders who receive a prison sentence of 3 months or less are reconvicted of an offence within 2 years. This is because such short sentences have highly limited scope for rehabilitation. According to the Prison Reform Trust, virtually all women in prison in Scotland have a history of problematic use of drugs or alcohol or both. The Trust reports that over 70% of women in prison have reported using drugs in the last year, and that 1 in 3 are currently on methadone. Around half say they were under the influence of alcohol when they committed the offence for which they are imprisoned, a figure higher than for male offenders. Similarly, 7 out of 10 female prisoners have a disclosed history of abuse or trauma. Prison is a hugely counterproductive environment for many of these women. As I've mentioned, women also tend to commit less serious offences than men. The most common crime that resulted in a custodial sentence for women in 2013-14 was shoplifting, with 1 in 4 custodial sentences being provided for this crime. Only 5% of women who received custodial sentences were convicted of serious crimes, such as homicide, attempted murder, serious assault, robbery, and only a handful of women a year, are imprisoned for long sentences of more than 4 years. We should also keep in mind, and colleagues have mentioned this afternoon, that a higher proportion of the female prison population is there on remand than of the male population. 70% of female remand prisoners do not go on to receive a custodial sentence. It's also important to acknowledge the increased effectiveness of women-specific interventions, whether custodial or non-custodial. According to the Howard League for Penal Reform Scotland, 83% of women who use the services at the 218 service in Glasgow, and I have not visited that service, for example, reported significant decreases in drug and or alcohol use, while 67% indicated improvements in their overall health and well-being. It's certainly a service I'd like to go and visit in the very near future. This is one of the many examples of successful women-specific tailored interventions. Another is in Fife, where Fife Council Criminal Justice Social Work Service has adopted a multidisciplinary approach to women offenders, with input from the NHS, Women's Aid, the Scottish Prison Service and many other agencies. So I really welcome the commitment this afternoon to additional funding for such services. That can only be good news. Because it's troubling to me that we are now sending twice as many women to prison than we did in 2000, even though the female crime rate has dropped significantly since then. We can see the effects of this at a local level. In Fife, in February 2009, there were 27 women in custody and 330 in community-based supervision. That's 8% in custody and 92% in the community. By July 2013, there were 49 women in custody and 456 women subject to community-based supervision. As the Scottish Prisons Commissioner said, increased use of prisons is the result of using it for those who are troubled and troubling rather than dangerous. I therefore have no problem agreeing with the Government's amendment and its acknowledgement of the Angelini report and its proposals for dealing with women offenders. As I've outlined, it's clear that prison does not work for most women, nor does it work for families. Nearly two-thirds of women in prison have children. When a father goes to prison in Scotland, 95% of children continue to live with their mother. But when a mother goes to jail, fewer than one in five stays with their father. The others are sent to live with other family members or find themselves placed into care. A large number end up having no contact with their mother. The Angelini report demonstrated that women prisoners who have regular contact with their children are less likely to re-offend. We also know that the children of women in prison are more likely to suffer trauma, with one in three children with a parent in prison developing serious mental health issues. This affects almost 450 children in this country at any given time. So I very much welcome the Scottish Government's decision not to build the proposed women's prison at Inverclyde. I know that this position has widespread support. Barnardo's, the Howard League of Penal Reform, Circle Scotland, Scottish Quakers Community Justice Network, Women for Independence, Professor Andrew Coyle, King's College London, the International Centre for Prison Studies, Baroness Jean Corston, and the thousands of people, myself included, who signed an online petition set up by Edinburgh Women for Independence. Scottish Labour's plan to cancel the building of the new facility and reinvest the costs associated with it in far more successful and humane community-based sentences and family justice centres tailored for women would cut crime and re-offending. It costs almost £32,000 a year to keep someone in prison. The human cost is incalculable. Finally, and on a related topic, the Scottish Sentencing Council is an important development. The Sentencing Council would provide an opportunity for a wider range of voices to be heard in the sentencing process, and I'll end as I began, by emphasising that we must do what works. I hope the Scottish Government will now proceed on that basis. Thank you.
Thanks so much. I now call on Gil Paterson to be followed by Richard Simpson.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be speaking in this debate on women offenders and how best we can deal with this problem. And this being my first as a member of the Justice Committee, although it's an issue that I've been involved in and paid close attention to for a good number of years. My starting point is that sometimes the only place an offender should be, and that includes women, is prison. However, sometimes the wrong place for an offender to be is in prison, and that's particularly the case for too many women. We know that the likelihood is that those who commit low-level offences and who are given short sentences in prison are more than likely to re-offend on release. There is little or no time for the Scottish Prison Service to work with these short-term offenders in order to rehabilitate them and ensure that they are less likely to re-offend on release, and so the cycle goes on. Some members of the public are of the opinion that offenders should be punished, and that's the end of it. Just punish them and be done with it. But in general, the public look long-term with the view that by engaging with offenders and in ensuring that prison or other methods are used to rehabilitate them will cut the risk of re-offending in the future. They know full well that increased crime equals more misery for the community and greater public spending on dealing with it. It would be a far better idea to spend the taxpayers' money on ways to stop re-offending and to assist those who are caught in the cycle of crime to get out of it. When it comes to many women offenders, the figures show that they are more likely to commit low-level crime and be sentenced to prison time. This has a negative consequence not only for themselves, but for their family, and this must be addressed. In my view, with the impact of serving their sentence, hitting their children hard through the loss of their mother and, in some occasion, being taken under care of social services, women in prison have a greater burden and this will only have a negative impact on their mental well-being. Women are less likely to be morally or financially supported by their partners whilst in prison, and that includes partners and husbands and boyfriends and fathers looking after the children. Therefore, addictions are heightened, illness and long-lasting depression are increased, and women suffer disproportionately from this, which could be tied to their natural maternal instincts being challenged through losing touch with their family unit, particularly their children. It's with this in mind that I'm particularly pleased with the Scottish Government, and in particular how the new Justice Secretary, Michael Matheson, has the courage, and it is courage, to review in the first place the change of direction and implement that change. The proposed new women's prisons in Greenock is what I'm talking about. I think that was a bold and courageous move. Sometimes people consider it as the wrong thing to change their mind, but governments too often don't. So I very much welcome the Cabinet Secretary's emphasis on this change, which will bring about more emphasis on smaller and local-based units. This has a number of benefits, including the offenders being closer to their family and children, which I believe will make a huge difference. And I would suggest to go even further and work towards making prison for low-level crimes an exception rather than a rule. I'm a great believer in preventative spending. We've spent a lot of time in the Health and Sport Committee on that. However, I do get a bit annoyed when stats are used for political point scoring instead of looking to tackle the issue. Simply put, if we are diverting resources to preventative spending, it stands to reason that in the long term, you will not be spending the same level on existing services, and in particular at a time of economic hardship as we are in now, and restricted budgets. If you invest in preventative spend, then you simply cannot spend it twice. I do believe in cutting the number of women who are sent to prison and using the savings from to support programmes that are based in the community for offenders. This is preventative spend at its best, and the dividends will be great benefit to the public, who will be pleased at seeing a reduction of persistent low-level crimes. But for me, the goal of seeing fewer women in prison who shouldn't be there is seeing the lives of women and children and the wider families made better or even transformed. And it would be a great achievement, and one that we can all get some satisfaction. Therefore, we need a political truce between all the parties in this chamber and agree to focus our energies on positive action so that we can take joint ownership of a strategy for the long term. Otherwise, political expediency will once again be the victor. So I'm very pleased to support the amendment in the name of Michael Matheson, MSP, and I commend it to the Parliament today. Thank you.
Thanks so much. Now I call on Dr. Richard Simpson, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Presiding Officer, I want to begin, as I do in almost all my speeches I make in this chamber, by praising the Government for the things they're doing right, and in particular this courageous decision by the new Minister to cancel the prison. I have to say to him, I was faced with exactly the same situation when I became a Minister. SPS were proposing 3 or 4 new private prisons, and I had to say to the First Minister, Jack McConnell, that was not something I could accept. And in fact, we changed it to 1 new private prison, Addiewell, and 1 public sector delivery, which transpired under Kenny McCaskill, which was eventually Lumos. I have to say to him, too, that the Scandinavian model, which we often talk about in this chamber, is one of very much fuller prisons generally. The average prison size in Scotland of our 15 prisons is 495. This is actually far too large. I've worked in a prison, and I know what the situation is. I'll come back to that. I want to praise the Government for the Angelini Commission, which I think has been excellent and referred to by many speakers today, and for attempting through the McLeish Commission to address the issue of sentencing. And that's something we need to come back to with the Sentencing Council. I want also to praise the tone of the new minister's approach to his portfolio, in particular his expressed desire to work with all parties in order to achieve approach. And Gil Paterson's right, we need a truce on this issue. We need a commonality in our approach. We need to find a way forward for women offenders, and this is not new. So I want to deal with some of the history, in particular since the mid-1980s, and then I'll address a little bit about the new approach. Presiding officer, I had the privilege of working as a deputising medical capacity in Cortonville Prison from the day it opened in 1976 until I was elected to the Parliament. And during those 23 years, I witnessed a number of significant changes, but they were, in my view, quite insufficiently radical to address the underlying issue. Because as a country, as every speaker has said, we're sending far too many women who are not violent, who are not a threat to the public or to themselves, to prison, and individuals whose main problem are health and social problems. Now, the Scottish Prison Service did respond positively to many of the challenges they were faced with. For example, suicides in Cortonville, where they introduced the Samaritans and then the Listener Service, and then, secondly, a new protocol called Act to Care. And that, we should note, members, had the effect of reducing suicides in Scottish prisons generally well below that in England. The big change, however, between 1987 and when I became a minister in 2001 was those who presented with a history of drug use. That was actually only 10 people in 1987. By 2001, it was well over 80% of the population. Labour also recognised in the early part of the Parliament that there was a significant and growing problem with alcohol in the general population. And of course, we then brought in the Licensing Act 2005. Ian Gray established the McLean Commission, and I was the minister who took that over. And that produced some radical proposals, one of which was that women offenders whose offence was related to drugs should not be sent to prison for short-term sentences, but to what they called the time-out centre, and which many members have referred to as the 218 Bath Street Centre. This diverts 500 women a year from short-term custody, a not insignificant number of receptions, but it doesn't have a big effect upon the daily population. Now, it took until 2006, because it had a slightly rocky start, to prove its worth. But it is my regret that neither in our last year nor in the years of the present government that this has not been replicated. Too often, we have good pilots, demonstrably effective, and we don't then follow it up. We go for more pilots. These should be replicated now in Edinburgh, Dundee and Aberdeen. And there also should be a pilot for this for male offenders. Moreover, this shouldn't simply be for those with a drug problem, but for those for an alcohol problem, because this has, in fact, become an even more significant factor. Again, for a while it was much less. The figures from the 2013 prisoner survey are stark. 55% reported committing an offence while using drugs, 50% saying they were intoxicated at the time of the offence, and that was up from 42% in the 2011 survey. And does prison help? Because if it does, then let's continue it. Well, 9% of women offenders started using drugs for the first time while in prison. 42% used drugs whilst in prison, and only 12% reduced drug use while in prison. This is ineffective. Colleagues, it is a waste of our money. It has to change. On alcohol, the Scottish Prison Service are using the WHO-recommended screening tool audit. But, you know, only 30% are reported being assessed, and only 20% said they'd received any form of treatment. This is wholly inadequate. Presiding officer, Labour evaluated and rolled out drug treatment and testing orders. We opened pilot drug courts in Glasgow, followed by another court in Fife. We piloted tagging on remand, which now should be revisited more strongly. We worked with SACO to increase bail supervision, which has subsequently been reduced. We introduced restorative justice, which has not been followed through. We ensured that women would keep their infants with them in prison, very important for early attachment. We ensured that Open Secret worked in Cortonville with survivors of sexual abuse, which we know are significant numbers, as Dobash and Dobash reported. Almost 70% may have been abused either through childhood or domestic abuse. We worked hard to reduce further the number of women admitted with fine default. And I have to say that's been successful, with a reduction from around 600 when I was the minister to 84 by 2008. Again, doesn't affect the daily population, but does affect receptions. And presiding officer, the problem is that receptions are the biggest churn. They have doubled, and they are being sent to prison by sheriffs because the sheriffs feel they have no alternative. We have got to do better. We have got to do better now.
Many, many thanks. I now call on Stuart McMillan to be followed by Mike McKenzie.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I've listened to all the contributions today, and it's clear that there is political consensus across the Chamber regarding the best way to treat women offenders. Now, I don't intend retreading many of the arguments that actually have been aired, but I will focus my attention and my initial remarks on the amendment that was put forward by the Cabinet Secretary, where in the amendment it says not to proceed with the plans for HMP Inverclyde as a prison for women. I'll then turn to the actual issue of treating women offenders later. I met with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice yesterday to discuss a number of justice-related matters, and the issue of HMP Inverclyde was just one of them. The meeting was organised a few weeks ago, and certainly following on from the announcement on Monday, the meeting certainly proved to be very timely. And it has been widely accepted and acknowledged that to treat women offenders differently and to have less reoffending, then a different approach was required, and the Cabinet Secretary set out that position very clearly on Monday and continually since then. The decision does, however, go some way to leaving a gap in employment opportunities in the Inverclyde area, however, with £7.8 million already been spent on preparing the site, and with the total project to have been £75 million, then that actually would have been a welcome boost to the Inverclyde economy, and that's something that I'm on record as saying over the last, come back to 2008, when the initial proposals were actually taken forward. With the decision not to proceed, It did concern me that the Scottish Government would be open to cries of money being wasted and with no future plans for the site, and we have already heard some of that already this afternoon, Cabinet Secretary. These and other points were just some of those that we did discuss yesterday during the meeting. I am pleased, however, that the Cabinet Secretary did inform me that the site is to refer back to its original purpose, and that is the new build prison to replace the existing HMP Greenock. The timing of this replacement is longer than certainly that I would have anticipated, and I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary as well, but certainly it will present itself for future development. Now that the SPS own the site and that they will have prepared the site for any future construction process for a prison, it should be easier to facilitate going forward. However, if the replacement for the men's prison were to take a few years to progress, as I imagine it certainly will do, due to the capital budget cuts that this government has been receiving and is receiving, then actually what was actually going to happen to the site in the meantime? The Inverclyde local plan indicates that the site is for a replacement prison and already obviously has the planning permission. If a developer or an employer comes forward and indicates that they would actually like to take the land for future use, would there be challenges as it goes against the local plan? And also, would the SPS consider selling the land to allow this to happen? Presiding Officer, I actually make no apology for focusing my initial remarks today on that particular situation facing the Inverclyde and its economy. And I believe that the Cabinet Secretary is correct in how best we actually treat women offenders. And this change in direction has clearly been welcomed by many. But just like my colleague Bruce Crawford, MSP, just like what he did yesterday in the Chamber, he posed a question for actually what was going to be the best interests for his constituents. So certainly I'm doing the same today when I raised that particular issue. A £75 million construction project would have had huge economic benefits for the Inverclyde economy. Then there would also have been the continual running costs once a prison was created. That's also now not going to happen for a period of time. But I did listen to the Cabinet Secretary on the radio yesterday when he was asked would one of the smaller regional units be built in the Greenock site, and indicated this probably wouldn't happen. But certainly that was an issue that we did discuss yesterday. My concern with the site is that the SPS own it, and certainly by the end of March, when the preparation works are concluded, the site will lay dormant for a period of time. And I certainly would like to see a firmer timeline as to when the site would be utilised, and I appreciate that, that with the huge change in direction that the SPS will now be undertaking, that this timeline isn't going to occur overnight, but I certainly am keen for that to happen. But I am content that the works that have taken place will actually assist the SPS with their future plans and how to deal with both male and female prisoners. And I'm sure that many lessons will have been learned, which will certainly be able to put to good use to treating offenders across the country and for future investment decisions. I'm now going to move on to just to deal with the issue of women offenders. Yesterday I received an email from Positive Prison, Positive Future, highlighting that they are welcome for the decision, and they indicated that one of the volunteers, Kim, was involved in TV programmes indicating how beneficial non-custodial sentencing had actually been for her. And she had received a community order, but it was the most difficult thing that she had ever done. And as she put it, if it was not for that order, I would either be in prison or dead. Now, I was given permission to actually highlight Kim's example of how a different approach can both help with prevention activities as well as actually help keep people alive. Now, there sometimes can be an impression that, that non-custodial sentences are the soft option, but they do actually have a huge part to play. And presiding officer, as the Cabinet Secretary said in his earlier comments, the new approach that will be taken will actually be bolder, it will be radical, and it will be more ambitious to actually tackle such an important issue. The Commission on Women Offenders by Dame Eilish Angelini produced a set of challenging recommendations for the Scottish Government, which certainly has been has achieved cross-party support. Actions on these recommendations have already started, but there is certainly more to do, which has already been alluded to this afternoon. The Cabinet Secretary and his new approach will, I'm sure, deliver further on these recommendations, and I do welcome the £1.5 million extra funding that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned. But ultimately, Presiding Officer, what we should be aiming for is for a reduction in reoffending, better outcomes for former offenders, and a more collaborative approach between mainstream service providers. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Mike McKenzie, after which we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I knew if I waited long enough, I might eventually see a Labour motion that welcomed a decision made by the Scottish Government. So I'd like to place on record my welcome for their welcome. And patience often eventually pays off, as it's paid off for penal reformers across Scotland, who rightly see this decision signalling a new and a more enlightened approach to penal policy. And it's hard to disagree with what Labour say in their motion, except to note a slightly grudging tone and turn of phrase. And in considering the matter of penal reform, I'm reminded of Philip Larkin's great poem, where he says, "Man hands on misery to man, it deepens like a coastal shelf." I'm not as pessimistic as Mr. Larkin was, but he did neglect to say that we hand misery on to women too, perhaps more so than we do to men, and worse than that, we hand it on to children. And the signs that we have been getting penal policy wrong for women have been there for far too long, highlighted by increasing offending and reoffending rates. And it's not just that current policy has been ineffective. It's not just that penal sentences carry a high financial cost. It's not just that the effect is to pass this misery on down through the generations. It's also, if you merely keep on doing the things in the same old way, you tend to get the same old inadequate results. And the Tory amendment seems to me to be one that's wedded to the status quo, and it seems to betray a lack of understanding of all that this decision signals. It's not just about another prison built somewhere else, but about certainly.
Margaret Mitchell.
I'm wondering how he reaches that conclusion, given the very specific member reference to the constructive recommendations in the Dame Angelini report.
I do make intervention through the microphone, Ms. Mitchell, please. Mike McKenzie.
Thank you for that intervention, and I did note that at the very end of the motion. However, the bulk of the motion seems to be, I think, overly critical of the government's decision. So it's not just about getting a prison built somewhere else, but it's about a whole new approach that takes on board almost everything recommended in Dame Angelini's report. And the Tories are concerned about the timescale of the decision, but surely it's wiser to delay a decision a bit and take the right decision rather than to rush to take a wrong one. And they're concerned too about the financial implications. But the overbearing financial consideration is not about the immediate cost of the decision, and the enlightened reforming road this decision represents, but it's about the high cost of maintaining and remaining with the status quo. We know that the average cost of a community payback order is around £2,400, approximately half the cost of a three-month prison sentence. And we know that the economic and social cost of reoffending over a 10-year period is around or over £75,000 per female offender. And we know that these costs are increasing as offending and reoffending rates for women increase. What we're not so sure about is about the link between increasing female offences and the recession, what that link is. We suspect there is one, but we don't have precise information about that. We're not so sure about the link between this and welfare cuts, certainly.
Dr. Simpson.
The number of people charged and going to the Crown Office property of the Fiscal Service has not increased. And it really hasn't increased. So the number of people in charge has not increased. He is wrong.
Mike McKenzie.
Yes. I can't help but wonder about the link between that and the increase of shoplifting offences. And what we're not so sure about are the full ramifications of the Westminster policies of austerity, and beyond the knowledge that they're all deeply damaging and that they'll present us with a very significant financial legacy. So, Presiding Officer, we must stop handing down this misery and passing it down through the generations. It's necessary to break this link, and it's no surprise that there are lessons in how to do this from some of the Nordic countries. So I look forward to seeing the Cabinet Secretary putting these reforms into practice. I suspect there will be lessons there in how we deal with men as well as women. And Dame Angelini's report is a breath of fresh air. That's why I'm so pleased to see the Cabinet Secretary pay such close attention to the report. That's why I'm so pleased that he's taken the time to take the right decision. And that's why I'm so pleased that he's had the courage to make a wise decision.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches. And before I invite Alison McInnes to close on behalf of the Liberal Party, I'd invite all members to join us for the closing speeches, those who are not in the chamber. Alison McInnes, 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. I'm pleased the debate today has been largely consensual. It reflects a growing realisation of the immense benefits of a holistic, multi-agency approach to offending. The Commission on Women Offenders, as we all know, provided a framework for the transformation of alternatives to prosecution and remand. It justified an overhaul in sentencing practices, and it demanded better through care services. Services which transcend prison walls, services that continue to support women when they are released, services focused on successful reintegration. And this afternoon's debate has made it clear that there is cross-party support for implementing this package of reforms. And I therefore emphasise that a half-hearted or a pick-and-mix approach to implementing the Commission's recommendations is simply not coherent. It is not justified by the evidence of what works. HMP Inverclyde risked entrenching failure. Spending £75 million on a new prison would have perpetuated many of the shortcomings that we've heard about from members this afternoon. That spend dwarfs the £3 million the Scottish Government has invested in community projects for women during the last 3 years, and Kezia Dugdale rightly calls for these to receive sustainable funding. We must ensure they are part of a permanent network of credible, trusted alternatives to custody. We're talking about safe, structured environments such as the 218 service, focused on the issues that underpin offending, mental and physical ill health, addiction, sexual and physical abuse. Early intervention has contributed to a transformation in how the justice system deals with young offenders, but I fear we've barely scratched the surface when it comes to women offenders. And once again, Quantum Vale sadly offers the most distressing evidence. 80% of inmates have mental health problems. They are 10 times more likely to self-harm than male prisoners. Problems are not being identified, addressed, or accounted for early enough. And I return again to the prolonged use of isolation, which I think is indicative of the challenging and complex behaviour which prison service staff must cope with as a result. My parliamentary questions revealed women were held in solitary confinement for extended periods of time on 144 occasions in 2013-14. In the worst case I am aware of, one woman was isolated for a total of 387 days during a 17-month period. Long-term solitary confinement does little to support rehabilitation or address underlying trauma. Rather, it risks compounding the serious mental health conditions that so often underpin offending behaviour. Parliament, we should be ashamed that it's being relied upon as a management tool for borderline personality disorder and post-traumatic stress disorder. It is completely out of step with the 21st century criminal justice system. Now, I welcome that the Chief Inspector of Prisons is reviewing the use of segregation and separation, although I am, however, dismayed to learn of a delay in that work. I had believed that it was going to be presented to us in February, and I understand it might now be the summer. The orders for this extended segregation are signed on ministers' behalf. The last Justice Secretary claimed that was an operational matter, and he couldn't tell me who was signing the orders off or if any had ever been declined or revoked. They can be renewed indefinitely with no system of external review, and I think that is dreadful. The Justice Secretary is responsible for ensuring Scotland has a humane prison regime, and he must provide clear leadership on this. I urge him to look at this and amend the prison rules so that an independent panel can consider whether back-to-back isolation orders are appropriate in all cases. And I would ask him to instruct a review of the provision and resourcing of services for these vulnerable women. The Commission on Women Offenders recommended this almost 3 years ago. These steps are essential if basic human rights are to be protected. We know that the prison service has a responsibility to accommodate those women it has sent by the courts. But so often, as we've heard this afternoon, prison is simply not the right place for them. The Committee for the Prevention of Torture and Inhumane or Degrading Treatment urged the Scottish Government to ensure the swift transfer of vulnerable prisoners to appropriate psychiatric facilities. I know in one recent case that took almost 9 months. So the NHS must take more responsibility for their care. The Mental Welfare Commission tells us that women in custody are asking for more professional support from psychiatrists or psychologists. It confirmed that the care they receive in prison is nothing in comparison to settings such as hospitals. More in-depth assessments and reporting could also help judges make the right choice during sentencing and custody hearings. The fact that 70% of women remanded in custody don't go on to receive a custodial sentence demonstrates something is going badly wrong. Presiding Officer, I'm determined that halting the building of HMP Inverclyde should not result in a vacuum, because Scotland's justice system cannot continue to fail these women any longer. It cannot continue to fail them every step of the way, from prosecution to rehabilitation. I'm reminded of comments from the Lord Justice Clerk, Lord Carloway. He suggested that future generations may reflect on our placing of so many people behind walls and barbed wire as simply barbaric. In closing, it's worth noting that all members commended the Justice Secretary on his change of tack, and rightly so. But let's not kid ourselves that the way forward is now easy. Richard Simpson and Gil Paterson spoke of a political truce, and Christine Graham said Parliament must now show leadership. I urge everyone to work together to redraw the landscape for women in the justice system. And we better prepare for a marathon, not a sprint. But let's stay the course, because the prize is great.
Many thanks. I now call on Animal Goldie. 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, this has been an important debate and a timely one, and I want to thank the Labour Party for using the parliamentary timetable so effectively to bring the issues of the new women's prison and how we deal with women offenders before us today. Because let's be clear, there is another timetable here, one which is uncomfortable for the Scottish Government. I recall clearly speaking in a justice debate in this chamber on 26 April 2012, and that was in consequence of the Eilish Angiolini report, which was universally welcomed. And can I just quote from the report? Point one, the female prison population in Scotland has doubled in the past 10 years. Point two, many women in the criminal justice system are frequent reoffenders with complex needs that relate to their social circumstances, previous histories of abuse and mental health and addiction problems. Point three, it has been widely recognised that there is an urgent need for action to reduce the number of women reoffending and going to prison. This report attempts to address these issues and provide pragmatic recommendations. Point four, there are women who should be in prison to protect the public and to mark the seriousness of their crimes. Point five, even for these women, opportunities for rehabilitation should be available to reduce the likelihood that they will reoffend and help reintegrate them back into the community. Now, I give that quote, Deputy Presiding Officer, just to remind people of where we were nearly 3 years ago, after extensive dialogue and consultation. Let me say, I agreed with these points then, I agree with them now. I felt the report was a model of brevity and clarity. It provided not just a clear signpost, but a detailed roadmap for the journey we were to make. And the report also proposed a new national prison for women offenders that anticipated the facility would be smaller than Cornton Vale. So here we are nearly 3 years on, with no new smaller prison. We have an abandoned plan for a large capacity facility in Greenock. Now let me make clear, like Kezia Dugdale, I applaud Mr Matheson's courage. It was tough for him to do it, but he has made the correct decision. But what we are entitled to ask is what the Scottish Government has been doing over the last 3 years. What has been going on? What was Mr Matheson's predecessor playing at? Because this is ineptitude on stilts. And of course questions arise. And let me just give an example of some of these questions. We knew that Cornton Vale was no longer fit for modern purpose. For how long can it function? And will it close in 2018? And the Cabinet Secretary in his remarks, and it was a welcome observation, referred to two new national facilities. Well, you know, what is the timescale for these? What is the budget for these? Are they going to cost £70 to £100 million for both, or cost that for each? And the dialogue to which he has referred, and I have a great deal of sympathy with what Margaret Mitchell was saying, if you take into account not just the work of the Angelini Commission, but the work of the Equal Opportunities Committee of this Parliament, talk has been going on for 7 years. So how long will this further dialogue last? And these proposed new facilities, are there locations for them? I do sympathise with Mr McMillan's personal interest about the Inverclyde area, but I think the rest of us want to know what is the grand plan and will these facilities definitely fit into some kind of hub and spoke configuration? And of course, we are told the cost of abandoning the proposal for Inverclyde amounts to £7.8 million. Is that... I want to make a further point, if you'll forgive me. Is that the final cost? Are there more costs to be encountered? Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, without answers to these questions, I have to say that the amendment in Mr Matheson's name is an aspiration, a worthy one, no doubt about that, but it's not a plan. It's too vague. And there is no reference to these new facilities to which he referred in his speech this afternoon. Deputy Presiding Officer, Angelina, Dame Eilish Angelini, in her report, expressed concerns about women in prison. And I think, you know, some members, notably Jane Baxter, think referred very eloquently to what some of these concerns are. The number of women who have children who end up in prison. The number of women who have witnessed violence between their parents or carers when they were children. The drug and alcohol addictions which plague many, many women in prison. Mental health, which apparently affects 80% of women at Cornton Vale. Housing. Women are more likely than men to lose their housing while in custody and then be homeless and released. And employment. Just 39% of women in prison who'd access services to help them prepare for release had sought advice on employment and only 22% on training. Now, I say this, Deputy Presiding Officer, not to impugn the Cabinet Secretary's courage, which I admire. He's done the right thing. But I do point out that nearly 3 years ago, we anticipated by now moving on to implement of the Angelini proposals. Instead, we seem to be in a vacuum, in a state of stasis, still talking. Now, I realise the Cabinet Secretary has fallen heir to this mess, and he has my sympathy. But he must now answer the questions which are being raised, because the buck does now stop with him, and victims and women offenders, and very importantly, the public interest, will now demand answers.
Now call on Paul Wheelhouse, a generous 8 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to be part of such an important and largely, almost entirely consensual and thoughtful debate this afternoon. Clearly, members across the chamber have a very keen interest in getting better outcomes for women in the criminal justice system. And indeed, Alison McInnes, Christine Graham, I hope you're both right in the fact that this will herald perhaps an opportunity to move forward together as a parliament, having the decision having been made. This is a hugely important subject, a subject this government has shone a light on since we established the Commission on Women Offenders in 2011, which was chaired by, as we've heard today, the former Lord Advocate Dame Eilish Angelini. I thank Richard Simpson for his kind words on that decision, indeed, and the approach taken by the Cabinet Secretary today in his new post. Rod Campbell is right. This was not an overnight decision. I'll return to that point. The Cabinet Secretary announced his decision on Monday that the Scottish Prison Service's plans for a women's prison in Inverclyde should not go ahead because it does not fit with his vision of how a modern and progressive country should be addressing female offending. The decision, though, is about much more than bricks and mortar. I will come back to the points that Annabel Goldie and indeed Stuart McMillan have made, but it is much more than about bricks and mortar. This is what the Cabinet Secretary alluded to in his comments to the Justice Committee in December last year. And this government believes that we need to be bolder and take a more radical and ambitious approach in Scotland. And when it comes to the justice system, we must be smarter with the choices we make and more sophisticated in the way in which we deal with female offenders and take a preventative approach, as stated by Gil Paterson. As the Cabinet Secretary has already indicated this afternoon, we want to take an evidence-based approach, one which is much more effective in tackling the number of female offenders we have in Scotland. Mike McKenzie, Gil Paterson and Jane Baxter are absolutely right to highlight the cost of incarceration. And as many have said, for some 2 decades now, there have been calls for the need to reduce our female prison population in Scotland. And over those 2 decades, our female prison population has almost doubled. So it seems to me that if we want to really fundamentally shift the approach that we are taking in tackling these issues, then we need to really radically change our penal policy. And to do that, we need to make sure that we tackle the underlying causes of offending in the first place, as Kezia Dugdale and so many other members have acknowledged today. We need to help women access services and support that helps them tackle their issues with mental health, trauma, abuse, drug use and alcohol misuse, and all of the other issues that can result in someone getting involved in a cycle of reoffending. The Cabinet Secretary has signalled, as I said in December, that he and his officials have now entered into a period of dialogue, both with stakeholders and parliamentary colleagues across the chamber, and we will welcome, indeed, any constructive contributions from whichever part of the chamber they come from. And today is hopefully a good sign that constructive... Sorry, give way to Alison McInnes.
Thank you very much, Minister, for taking an intervention. The Cabinet Secretary was not able to address the amendment that I have today. Do you agree with me that dialogue with the judiciary is also important and that greater judicial diversity is important?
I'm happy to disappoint. Indeed, we do agree dialogue is important with the judiciary and we're happy to support the amendment. So that addresses the point Alison McInnes makes. This is an issue which was obviously as live during the Labour and Lib Dem administration as it is today, and I certainly welcome Kezia Dugdale's acknowledgement of this early on in her speech. We all have an interest in tackling it, as Christine Graham and Christine McKelvey have stated. And the Cabinet Secretary today also announced £1.5 million in 2015-16 to support community-based provision. This is consistent with this government's vision of how we will deal with women who offend in Scotland in the future, and that is something which I would expect everyone across the chamber to welcome. Our vision is for a female prison state which has appropriate and separate custodial accommodation for high-risk women, separate accommodation for young women, and where possible to achieve it, for the majority of women who are sent to jail, there should be smaller regional and community-based custodial facilities across the country. Stuart McMillan was quite right to focus on his constituency interests, but clearly I welcome the fact that he has engaged in dialogue with the Cabinet Secretary, as a constituency issue is obviously important to his local population. But clearly there will be occasions when it's necessary to look at custodial sentences for women, as a number of members have indicated, and indeed that is something that Dame Eilish reported in her own report. However, the evidence is clear that community sentences are more effective in helping to reduce reoffending and have the clear advantage allowing women to remain in the community with their families at the same time as they're taking part in targeted work to address the specific issues which are fueling their offending behaviour and helping to tackle their educational needs. Stuart Stevenson is absolutely right to address the issue of literacy and numeracy, and indeed Richard Simpson, I believe, gave some useful evidence on that point in his intervention. As the Cabinet Secretary for Justice has for justice already made clear to the Chamber, this government is determined not to accept the premise that female numbers, prisoner numbers must inevitably continue to rise, and to reduce the female prison population and to have more women doing the tough work they need to turn the lives around in the community is a more desirable approach. Stuart McMillan referred to a lady called Kim earlier on, who went on the radio the other day, and I just want to read very briefly your forbearance, presiding officer. She said, in respect to whether she had considered a custodial sentence and what she thought about that at its time, she said, "I was over the moon. I wanted to go to jail. Jail was an easier option to me than the troubled life I had outside prison, so I was all up for jail. You can just go in, keep your head down, that is that, you just forget about the other side. Whereas outside I had to go back and face my past and stuff, and then that was really hard. Supervision is the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. That is a major burden, so I don't know if I'd be here. I don't know." And I think that refers to the point that Stuart McMillan made. That is as powerful a testimony, I think, as we need to show why it's important to look at alternatives to incarceration. We have to provide high-quality community services for women that provide sentencers with confidence in alternatives to custody, and most importantly, provide the women themselves with the support they need. And to address Richard Simpson's point, things have moved on. This government has already made significant investment in community-based services for women, £3 million over 2 years, for the 16 projects that Kezia Dugdale and others have mentioned, as well as £18 million for reducing reoffending change fund, which offers mentoring support for prolific young male offenders and women offenders of any age across Scotland. As part of our wider work to reduce reoffending, the planned redesign of community justice places emphasis on collective responsibility through a partnership approach at a local level, bringing together a range of justice and non-justice partners and organisations, including local authorities, NHS boards, Police Scotland, the third sector and communities, to plan for and deliver improved outcomes. As has been set out in the Scottish Government's programme for government, and subject to parliamentary business, of course, we plan to introduce the Community Justice Bill to the Scottish Parliament in spring 2015. This legislation will enable a new model for community justice services in Scotland. It will incorporate local planning and delivery of community justice services through community planning partnerships, with duties being placed on bodies such as NHS boards, local authorities and Police Scotland, to engage in local strategic planning and delivery of services. This will be supplemented by the creation of a new public body, Community Justice Scotland, which will provide leadership, promote innovation, learning and development, provide assurances to ministers on the delivery of outcomes and drive improvement where it is required. This will ensure that community justice is given the profile and priority that is required to improve outcomes for all offenders across Scotland. And the closer alignment of planning for services for all of a community should support local partners to see clearly what their role is in sustaining the ongoing delivery of enhanced services for women that this government has supported over the last 2 years. Mike McKenzie is right, we need to avoid handing on the misery to the children of offenders. And while the focus of the Commission on Women's Offenders report was, of course, on women who offend, it is said that also that the evidence was overwhelming that intervening in early years of life would have significantly more impact on rates of offending than intervening later in life. But just as importantly, we also need to address the intergenerational aspect to our offending population, male and female, which often comes from the most deprived communities across Scotland. Elaine Murray, Mary Fee and Mike McKenzie remarked on those points. And the Commission strongly supported evidence-based parenting programmes and intensive family support. Please. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I just want to say in closing, if I may, that in summing up, Presiding Officer, I'd like to thank Kezia Dugdale for raising this issue today. It is a hugely important social justice issue. I look forward to the cross-party support members have indicated they will be providing as we continue to work to deliver Eilidh Shangilinni's Commission's recommendations. Thank you.
Too much. And I now call on Hugh Henry. Mr Henry, you have until 5:30 to wind up the debate, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of the things that frustrates me greatly about debates in this Parliament is the number of times that we all troop in here, we grind our gums, we say how much we agree with each other, we say how wonderful the debate is, we say that what we're talking about is fantastic and it's going to make a great difference to the people that we represent, and we all troop out satisfied that we've done the right thing, and then nothing happens. Absolutely nothing happens. We go through the motions, we pay lip service, and nothing changes. Well, I do hope that today, as Christine Graham said, that today is the day that we grasp the thistle. I hope that today is the day that we take the opportunity from this Labour business to actually say we are going to do something that makes a difference. Now, I don't underestimate the difficulty that Michael Matheson faced with this decision. And some people have said that he has taken his time to come to this decision. Well, you know, I've been in government as well, and I know just how slowly the wheels of government move. So actually, the decision that Michael Matheson has made in less than 2 months has been a remarkably swift decision for government. It's, in some senses, unprecedented. And for that, I pay tribute to him. I think it has been a courageous decision. I think it has been the right decision. And, you know, it cannot have been an easy one, not just because of some of the financial implications that will be associated with this decision, but it cannot have been an easy decision in completely reversing and overturning the decision of his colleague, his predecessor, particularly given that under the doctrine of cabinet responsibility, the present First Minister sat through and signed off the previous decision, which Michael Matheson has now overturned. So for that, he deserves credit. It did take courage, and it is the right thing, and therefore it's right that we should be associated with that as a parliament and give credit where it's due. And I'll come back to that, and I'll touch on you know, various points during the debate. Now, Kezia Dugdale talked about how long the Inverclyde project, the women's prison at Greenock, was live and was being considered, and you know, the time that had been spent, and indeed the money that had been spent on it. And certainly.
Ed McKenzie.
Do you accept that we've heard mentioned this afternoon about some of the preparatory work's been done, the site clearance work and so on, and obviously that has a cost attached to it. Do you accept that that's not money wasted?
Hugh Henry.
Well, I don't know yet if it's money that's wasted, because I don't know if it will all translate into the delivery of the replacement for Her Majesty's prison in Greenock. And if none of that money is wasted, well, fair play to you. However, at the moment, we have been told that £8 million has been spent on that, and we don't know if that is going to translate into anything. And indeed, that £8 million makes the £1.5 million that's been promised pale into insignificance. If only that £8 million had been spent on alternatives, then many of the community-based projects would be significantly better off. Now, you know, Kezia Dugdale spoke about the time that it has taken. And one of the things that I was pleased to see today, and my colleagues have been exhorting me to engage with Twitter. You know, I've just discovered what texting's about. So, you know, Twitter is a bit of a mystery to me. But I did look at it, and I was pleased to see that Kenny McCaskill had not lost his well-known sense of humour when he left office, because he's tweeted that he fully supports the decision of Michael Matheson. And one of the things that I do wonder about sometimes in here, it's fair enough when one party moves out of government and another comes in just to dish the previous lot and kid on that nothing good happened then. But for Kenny McCaskill to say that he supports Michael Matheson's decision, when up until this month that decision of his was still extant, is somewhat bizarre and indeed a bit humorous. I actually thought it was a spoof tweet at the beginning, but seemingly not. Now, we've heard about the coalition of support that is out there. And one of the things that did disappoint me in the government's amendment is that they are not willing to put on record and welcome the coalition of support that has made it possible for the Cabinet Secretary to reverse his decision. Sometimes I think we should give credit where it's due, not just to the Cabinet Secretary, but to all the groups out there that made it possible for us to have this decision. And it is slightly disappointing and curmudgeonly that that has not happened. No thanks, Stuart, not just now. So we have moved some way. And again, talking about credit where credit's due, if I take at face value what Michael Matheson has said, and if I take at face value what Paul Wheelhouse has said, that they want to work with the outside stakeholders and work across party lines, then a suggestion that I would make, that I've made last year and the year before in a number of debates, is the much mentioned Strathclyde Regional Council, which has come in for a lot of criticism over the years, but they had officer member group, working groups, reports, and they brought in experts and they brought in politicians of all parties to work together. This seems to me to be one where we could all come together and put our collective wisdom. And if you're going to do that, then the person that you need to be involved in this is actually Richard Simpson. Because one of the things, and I don't want to be particularly nitpicking about this, but in a few years, Richard Simpson, and he listed some of them, Richard Simpson put in place a number of things that have stood the test of time. And I, you know, DTTOs, tagging on remand, restorative justice, the issue of children of female offenders, abuse victims at Cornton Vale, find default initiatives. He did that in a very short space of time, and I was able to take some credit for some of that through the Time Out Centre and others, but that was the man that actually made the difference. And I contrast that to Kenny McCaskill's tenure in office. So if you want to make a difference, engage with all the parties, but also try to involve Richard Simpson. Now, the other thing that I think is an issue is that we do need the smaller facilities across Scotland. You know, for example, Jane Baxter talked about Fife. In Fife, we have nothing that keeps prisoners closer to their communities, not just for women offenders, but for male offenders. So we need to look at issues like that. But by far the biggest problem that we have in this country for female and for male offenders is the issue of remand. We have got too many people on remand that do not go on to serve a sentence. It's costing us a fortune, money that would be better spent, and if we can all work together to solve that problem, then let's do it. Let's make a difference. And we cannot ignore, as many of the outside stakeholders have said, that it's not just a question of alternatives to imprisonment, and Kezia Dugdale said some people don't like using that word. It's a question of working with offenders while they're in prison, helping them to change their ways so that when they come back out, they do not re-offend. So the whole question of rehabilitation also needs to be addressed. And we need to look at the support services outside prison as well. And some of the pressures that social work and criminal justice authorities are under is making it difficult for that to happen. And that's something that we all need to face up to, not just the Scottish Government. So, Presiding Officer, we have an opportunity here with this debate. We have an opportunity with this decision to actually change the way that we work as a Parliament. And it would be wrong of us if we turned away from that. The public out there, the experts, those interested in this issue, and indeed prisoners themselves, they will not thank us if we do not rise to this challenge. And I hope that in a few years' time, we will be able to look back and say that initiatives like the 218 Time Out Centre that Richard Simpson was involved in starting are now working effectively across the country. I hope that we are able to say, look at these figures, and it shows that there are fewer women going to prison than ever before, and by all means let Michael Matheson and the SNP government take the credit, but we will also be there saying we help to deliver that as well, because we are all in this together. What is happening with women offenders in this country is a scandal. Speaker after speaker has pointed out the number of women who go to prison for relatively trivial offences, the number of women who go to prison with mental health problems, the number of women who go to prison who have been the victims in their life of sexual and physical abuse, the number of women who are in prison with alcohol and drug addiction problems. We know what the issues are. What we haven't done so far is come up with an effective solution, although up to 2007 there were a number of initiatives tried and I think have stood the test of time. So here is the opportunity, Cabinet Secretary, for you to build on the praise that you have rightly received for your decision today. Here is the opportunity for you to show courage yet again in taking the next decisive step, and that is involve all the parties. Challenge us to face up to what you have done. Challenge all of us to cooperate. Let's build bridges with those outside that know the issues inside out, and let's all work together to finally make a difference.
Thank you. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 12165 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 12165.
Moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 12165 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 12166 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a stage 2 timetable for the Welfare Fund Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 12166.
Moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 12166, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 12168 on the Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2015 draft and motion number 12183 on the suspension of standing orders.
Moved.
Question on these motions will be put at decision time, to which we have now come. There are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. Can I remind members that in relation to the debate on women's offenders, if the amendment in the name of Michael Matheson is agreed, the amendment in the name of Alice McInnes falls. The first question then is that amendment number 12160.2 in the name of Michael Matheson, which seeks to amend motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale on women's offenders, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament's not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 12160.2 in the name of Michael Matheson is as follows. Yes, 62. No, 0. There were 54 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed to, and the amendment in the name of Alison McInnes falls. The next question is amendment number 12160.3 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, which seeks to amend motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale on women's offenders, be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now.
Aye.
before I read out the result of the vote, there seems to be a bit of consternation on the benches. As far as I can understand it, members are saying that we have called the wrong amendment. Can I say that I have now checked and we have indeed called the right amendment, Michael Matheson's amendment. Please, I'm speaking, sit down. The Michael Matheson amendment was 12160.2, which has been passed, which then means that the Alison MacInnes amendment, which is 12160.1, has fallen. The amendment I have just called is 12160.3 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, and that is the result that I am now about to give. So the result of the vote on amendment number 12160.3 in the name of Margaret Mitchell is as follows. Yes, 28. No, 62. There were 17 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale, as amended, on women's offenders be agreed to. Can we have some silence? The next question is that motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale, as amended, on women's offenders be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is not agreed to. We move to a vote. Members should cast their vote now. The result of the vote on motion number 12160 in the name of Kezia Dugdale as amended is as follows. Yes, 101. No, 0. There were 15 abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 12168 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on the Local Government Finance Scotland Order 2015 draft be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 12183 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick and the suspension of standing orders be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who are leaving the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.